We are going to investigate some further application of twisted convolution to the theory of Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space, and we discover a property which is very important, and property called to have a reproducing kernel. So actually the twisted convolution, which was described before, and we established the identity 85, which says what a twisted convolution between two wavelet transform will be again a wavelet transform with the first signal and second analyzing vector. It allows us to derive a conclusion for the case where both analyzing vectors, and so phi 1 and phi 2 analyzing vectors, and signal f2 will be the same function, the Gaussian, which we used to define the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space. So again, phi capital was used to denote the wavelet transform for the Gaussian. Then formula 85 for arbitrary function f, which is a wavelet transform of f small, will be read as follows. So we have twisted convolution with the wavelet transform that is the same, can be represented the same as the wavelet twisted convolution between two wavelet transform. So that will be again wavelet transform of a function of the function f times a factor which is inner product of Gaussian with itself, with properly normalized Gaussian, it's equal to 1. So twisted convolution with the phi capital return as function f for arbitrary function f to be in the space in the image of the wavelet transform. So that is called reproducing formula, and it's expressed in term of the twisted convolution. Actually, twisted convolution, as we defined before, that is just the integral operator. So twisted convolution was given by integral operator, where we have this part which is look like a convolution, and also there is a factor depending on the symplectic form which provide this additional twist to ordinary convolution. When having the integral twist of this type, we obtain that reproducing formula can be given by corresponding integral kernel. So that is integral kernel here, function k, exponent of just a product of double u z bar. So integration with kernel effectively reproduce the any function from the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space. That observation can be used to investigate linear operators, because for a linear operator, bounded linear operator with suitable function, we may interchange the order of linear operator and integration. So considering the action of an operator on a function from the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space, we represent this function as the twisted convolution of f and phi, and then our linear operator will infiltrate inside the integral and will actually act on the function phi itself. And this way we can represent any bounded linear operator on the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space as an operator of twisted convolution with the corresponding kernel, which is a function t acting on the phi capital. So for such an operator, we again may introduce the integral notation as a kernel, as a function of two variables, complex variables here, if we consider z to be x plus i y and double u x prime plus I y prime, so we can put it in notation with complex numbers. Then its properties which immediately follow for a bounded operator, what integral kernel for an operator, bounded linear operator T, is a function from Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space if we will leave dependence only from one variable, either z or double u. Also, for a bounded linear operator, we naturally get the estimation that the absolute value of kernel is just bounded by the norm of operator T and with factor, exponential factor, which come from the Gaussian measure. So that allow to reduce to a study of bounded linear operator on the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space to the study of corresponding twisted convolution. So for the operator we will have its integral kernel, and property of operator shall be reflected one way or another into the properties of this kernel. So here is that properties 1 and 2 is an illustration how operator and kernel can be connected. But there are many other results, many other more fine connections between these two objects. The inverse to Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform, as we already defined, through the contravariant transform. So here we have the definition. This is integrated transformation, integrated representation for function f applied to particular reconstructing vector b naught. So if we apply such a formula, reconstructing formula for a function f capital used in the to denote element of Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space, and use the Gaussian as the reconstructing vector, then the inverse transformation will turn the into the integral which we have for contravariant transform. If we will compare the inverse Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform and just the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform itself, so this is two formulas, we will see what the kernels are just complex conjugated one of another. So here this part which affected by the imaginary unit by complex conjugation change sign. So kernels are conjugated, and we also able to make the representation of this reproducing kernel in the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space, or the kernel between these two spaces, in terms of arbitrary orthonormal basis. So this is a kind of general theory, not particularly connected to properties of the Heisenberg group or other group. It's a general statement about the reproducing kernel spaces that having orthonormal basis phi small and phi capital in L2 and Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space, making generating function, as it's oftenly called, of this type out of these two orthonormal bases, and using corresponding variable z and x for them, we obtain a function, the kernel of function of two variables, which provide the integral transformation. And reproducing kernel itself can be expanded in a similar way to the sum based on the orthonormal basis phi capital into Fock Siegel Bartman space. Or any orthonormal basis is suitable here. There is, of course, more symmetry and simplification if this expansion is based on the ladder operators and elements here, the Hermite polynomial as an orthonormal basis into the L2 space on the real line, and corresponding monomials, powers of powers of variable Z, as we seen, form an orthonormal basis created by ladder operators on the Fock Siegel Bartman space, so that will be used as phi capital, and Hermite polynomials, not properly normalized, will be used as the orthonormal basis on the L2 space. So we can create corresponding kernels using this orthonormal expansion. Again, piece of this theory just come from the general construction of reproducing kernel Hilbert spaces, but proper choice of functions allow us to build these integral operators as intertwining operators between several representations, say Schrödinger representation on the real line and Fock Siegel Bartman representation on the Fock Siegel Bartman space. Recall that we define quantum mechanics in term of Hilbert space, vectors of Hilbert space, was describing the states of a quantum system, and observables of a quantum system was described by self-adjoint operators. So we now move to the next stage of our investigation. We already know how to analyze functions in terms of Waverly transform and corresponding representation of the Heisenberg group. Now we will move to the operators corresponding to observables, and we'll demonstrate what it's possible as well to represent them in certain term of coming back to the general definition of covariant transform. We define it in term of some fiducial operator which map our vector space to another vector space. We use the general setup to deal with operators, so that definition can be applied to operators as well. So if we have a representation of a group G on a vector space X, then we may extend our representation to the representation which will be acting on a collection of bounded linear operators from vector space X to Y. So a definition will be as follows: the transformed operator which we transform by element G will be just operator G applied to the transformed vector. So if you will compare how left shift say act on functions, so you will see certain similarity here. So we treat operator as a sort of a function where left shift on the group is replaced by corresponding linear representation. So if we will pick up the linear functional which will send our vector space, so for our vector space V, which is operator from X to Y, we are looking for a functional which send such operators from V to a complex number C, complex number in the field of from C. In particular, it's possible to pick up some vector X, some linear functional on the vector space y, then using this vector x and vector and linear functional L, we may build a functional F capital by such a pairing AX with L. And then we will obtain the corresponding covariant transform just as particular realization of previous general formula. So that covariant transform will assign to a given operator A function on the group, which we will denote A tilde, and this function will be treated as function representing of operator, and as function representing such an operator that is known as symbol. So in term of this symbolic calculus, when we assign a function to an operator, we are interested in translation of certain properties of the operator to properties of function and vice versa. We already met a similar type of translation of properties when we have discussed the operators on Fock-Siegel-Barman space. When we said that application of operator to the reproducing kernel produce a symbol for this operator, and certain properties of operator translated to the properties of the symbol. So that is a general situation in general other forms of group and representation. The similar questions are meaningful as well. Just to mention the Bayesian functional calculus, which may be derived from the two groups, maybe this is two copies of the same group, G1 and G2, acting on a space X and dual to the space Y, when action on the linear functional, which we defined on the previous slide. So, on the linear functional defined on the previous slide, linear functional like that, our double group, G1 cross G2, act correspondingly on X and linear functional L. And then this formula define the corresponding wavelet transform, which exactly reduced to the Bayesian functional calculus, Bayesian symbol of operator, if groups G1 and G2 are the same, and we are taking the same representation Rho1 and Rho2 for the case of a linear operator acting from a vector space X to itself. So generally, this particular situation, when we assign a function to an operator in term of quantum mechanics, can be linked to the transition from a quantum mechanical description to a classical one. It's known what observables in classical mechanics given by functions. So when we pick up an operator on a Hilbert space and produce its symbol, typically we expect what this symbol shall have some properties of classical observable for our quantum observables. Once we introduced the covariant transform for operators, we may similarly extend contravariant transform for the case of operator. I will remind what contravariant transform was: a case of integrated transform applied applied to the reconstructing vector. So for a function f, we make integrated transformation, integrated representation, integrated with representation rho, and apply to reconstructing function b naught. Similar definition can be done for our representation related to operators as well. So we pick up our representation rho certain function f and apply representation rho acting on operator A. Action on operators was defined on previous slides. So in this way, integral may be defined as the Bochner integral or integral in a weak sense, will converge to a certain operator. And this is a transformation which is opposite to covariant transform considered before. In case of covariant transform for an operator, we obtained function, its symbol. Here the situation just opposite, having a function which may be a symbol of our operator, when by means of this integration we reconstruct an operator. So typically two symbols, symbols obtained from covariant and used in contravariant transform, can be different, they may not coincide, and typical name for one symbol appearing from covariant transform, call it covariant symbol, and symbol used in contravariant transform called contravariant symbol. So again, that correspondence is different, and in with these two correspondences are different, and in the language of quantum mechanics, again, that transition from functions which we may consider as observables of classical system, we build operators which may be considered as observables of a quantum system. So that is a procedure of quantization. We move from classical. So the previous consideration of contravariant transform was rather general, and let us pick up the practical realization in terms of the Heisenberg group and its Schrödinger representation. So we use the formula related to integral representation. We just integrate the representation rho, the Schrödinger representation, with a function which is Fourier transform of certain function on the plane. When just using the definition of the Schrödinger representation, we may expand expression in term of shift and multiplication by exponent. Next transformation is using what for function A. We have Fourier transform, so we expand it as integral with corresponding exponent. And here turn out what integration over y is done only in term y appears only as element in both exponents. So combining all them together and taking the rule what integral of poor harmonic wave is just a delta function, we reduce integration by y to the delta function of this expression. So integration over y disappear from our consideration. Now that delta function of p minus t minus half x, if we integrate over the p, lead to the substitution of p with the value t minus half of x. So that appears in our symbol, that value of variable, and in final step we are making change of variable, t minus x became our new variable r. So we replace it by integration by r. So what we will have obtained is an integral operator, so for a function f, after that integration in q and r with a symbol a here and the expression of exponent, we will obtain some other function which we assign it to this operator. Operator is called pseudo-differential operator, so we will see reason why this happened. And the correspondence between function a and an operator is called Weyl correspondence. So here a is a Weyl symmetrized symbol, where is also Kohn-Nierenberg symbol, which is related to maybe just deduce it from the form of the Heisenberg group, which is polarized from the polarized Heisenberg group. In a similar way, integrating the representation of polarized form, we obtain Kohn-Nierenberg correspondence between symbol and operator. Name of pseudo-differential operator can be explained by the following property. If symbol AQR is a polynomial of degree n and variable q, when operating with the previous expression and Fourier transform, polynomial of variable q will be translated to the polynomial in the differential operator. So in this way, we will obtain just any operator with constant coefficient, differential operator with constant coefficient, as a particular case of pseudo-differential operator. And that gives a name if function is not polynomial, but something more general, when operator, corresponding operator, is called pseudo-differential operator. Again, the previous formula the previous formula for the pseudo-differential operators tell us what if A is a real valued function, when the adjoint operator to the with PDO will be just operator will be adjoint to the operator, will be operator with the symbol which is complex conjugated to the symbol A. In particular, if A is real valued function, then operator, pseudo-differential operator which we get, will be self-adjoint. This is a nice property in term again of quantization, correspondence of quantum and classical mechanics. Classical observables are real valued functions, and quantum observables are self-adjoint operators. So we have while correspondence is exactly send functions, real functions, to self-adjoint operator. So that is nice property. Kohn-Nierenberg calculus of pseudo-differential operator does not share that nice property, so it has more different connection between these two properties. Now interesting connection of pseudo-differential operator and its relation to the inner product. So if we will substitute definition of pseudo-differential operator as an integrated representation, it's easy to see that action turn out to be just integral operator with symbol a hat acting on the wavelet transform. Wavelet transform of function f with analyzing vector phi. And one property which we will use soon is the property regarding the shift of the symbol. So if we will define new symbol shifted with respect to shifted by A and B in the phase space, then new operator will be intertwined with the old one by means of unitary operator, which is just a representation of minus BA in the Schrödinger model. So we have immediately connection between two operators. So just Euclidean shift of of the symbol on the plane produce rather nice connection with operator. Again, it has a good interpretation in terms of quantum mechanics. So if A considered symbol to be a classical observable, when we are shifting with classical observable on the phase space, corresponding action on the quantum observables is producing by Schrödinger representation. So that is covariance of Weyl correspondence in terms of representation, Schrödinger representation of the Heisenberg group. And again, because we have the two integrated representations, it's easy to see that connection between composition of two such integrated representations is just the connection defined by the twisted convolution. So by the twisted convolution as we define it in our course, is an operation on the symbols, or rather on the Fourier transform of symbols, which shall be done in order to get the symbol of the composed operator. So effectively, we may already, from this point already deduce some rules how to operate with pseudo-differential operators, or say with quantum observables represented by this pseudo-differential operator. To make the correspondence between symbols and composition even more explicit, we may mention that Fourier transform is closely connected to twisted convolution itself. So actually, if we will consider what is it a twisted convolution with the constant function, so look on this expression for twisted convolution. So if function k2 is constant, so effectively it's disappeared from the integral, the remaining integral look very much as a Fourier transform. So for that transformation, the only difference what in exponent instead of the usual inner product in the vector space, we have symplectic form, skew symmetric form in this respect. So that transformation is closely connected or very similar to the usual Fourier transform, and correspondence differences between them are as follow. So we may note what integrated representation from the twisted convolution from the symplectic Fourier transform of a function, that is minus integrated representation of function itself, and Fourier second iteration of symplectic Fourier transform is identity. So if iteration of usual Fourier transform is a reflection, so usual Fourier transform is a map of order 4, symplectic Fourier transform is a map of order 2. Because we use that symplectic Fourier transform as a twisted convolution, when associativity of convolution implies that symplectic Fourier transform of a twisted convolution is just twisted convolution with one function to be symplectically Fourier transformed. And when expanding this corresponding relation, we see that Fourier transform, symplectic Fourier transform of the twisted convolution, so we pick up here the expression for the twisted convolution and expanded that exponent according to the Taylor series. And if we will do that expansion according to the Taylor series, then we will get the following infinite series. And so we have a kind of Taylor expansion for the composed kernel. And for us, it will be interesting to look on two first terms of this expansion. The first element in this expansion was just a product of symbols for our pseudo-differential operators. So composite symbols are the first term has just a product. And more interestingly, the second element in this expansion is what is known as Poisson bracket. So if you will substitute corresponding indices of order one in this expression, you will see a skew symmetric form, which is known Poisson bracket. And Poisson bracket is an element of classical mechanics, which define the corresponding dynamic on the phase space for a classical system. So essentially, the second term here is that Poisson bracket. Using the above formula for the composition of pseudo-differential operators, we may extend the correspondence between classical and quantum observables. So the Weyl correspondence assigned to a function A is pseudo-differential operator with symbol A, and the expansion for composition, as we said, given by such an infinite series. And if we will look on the commutator of two observables, then even numbered terms of even order will disappear here from the commutator. So if we will do it in opposite direction, so dE and ED products are the same, so subtracting one from another, we have cancellation of this term. But the next term is skew symmetric. If we change the order, we change the sign, so that term is surviving for the commutator, and this term is a leading term in the expansion of commutators. There are further terms of higher order here in that expansion, but for quantum commutator of the corresponding operators, the leading term in this expansion will be exactly the Poisson bracket, classical. As a final illustration of Heisenberg group technique in the theory of operator, we will make a proof of important result in the theory of pseudo-differential operators. The Calderon-Weierkurt estimates for L2 norm of pseudo-differential operators. So we will split it in several simple lemmas. The first interesting lemma give the estimate for the integrated representation of some group. So that lemma is of rather general nature. It's not for only for the Heisenberg group. So if we have an integrated representation, then its norm is estimated by the tensor product of left and right regular representation for function where we multiply f with the inverse reciprocal values of the wavelet transform of some mother wavelet with respect to itself. In particular, that can be Gaussian. It's not need to be, but it can be the Gaussian which we make as mother wavelet and transform to itself. So the proof is rather straightforward. So coming back to formulas about inversion of the covariant and contravariant transform. The composition of contravariant, covariant transform and representation rho, according to this formula, is just identity times the function phi capital. On the other hand, we may use some intertwining properties with the corresponding some intertwining properties for corresponding wavelet transform. So coming back to our formulas, initial formulas 48, which say that the wavelet transform intertwine representation rho with left regular representation, we may intertwine with rho with action of the left regular representation here, and else we have intertwining property for the right regular representation. So this is here, which says what right regular representation is intertwined with the action on the mother wavelet. So action of a rho here is intertwined with the right regular representation in this formula. So we have tensorial product of left and right regular representation. So left hand side of these two identities are equal, so it shall be equal and right hand side as well. So we just divide both sides by phi capital G, so we get what rho of G is equal phi capital of G divides this expression. When using triangle inequality, we integrate it with a function f, we will get the identity 100, inequality 100, as an estimate for the norm of the. I recall that this lemma is of very general nature, so it's not only for the Heisenberg group. But what make this particular lemma very useful for the Heisenberg group, this is the simple formula for the tensor product of left and right regular tensor product left and right regular representation on the Heisenberg group. Actually, what we have here, this is this expression is just the inner automorphism of the Heisenberg group. So this is inner automorphism, and it's turned out what it's reduced to the transformation of the central part of the group. So if we will integrate with arbitrary function with central action in the Schrodinger representation, then it effectively will be with this function, so that will be effectively the symplectic Fourier transform of the kernel. So essentially, just using particular property of the Heisenberg group, we get the next estimates. We get the next estimates for the integrated representation. So it's just given by supremum norm of symplectic Fourier transform of the function. So we get rid of operators, we estimate norm of certain operator, rather complicated operator, by a supremum norm of a function. So that is already a significant reduction to our the next step in our consideration will be elimination of this function phi capital from estimates. Recall what pseudo-differential operator is just integrated representation of the Heisenberg group, Schrodinger representation of the Heisenberg group, with the Fourier transform of the symbol. So when we find a function with a bounded function with compact support, which is inverse to the function phi on the some compact set, say a cube with edges at point minus 1 and 1, and then the standard properties of the Fourier transform implies that Fourier transform of a product will be equal to the convolution of the respective Fourier transform. So intertwining property of multiplication and convolution from the Fourier transform imply that relation. And for the norm, infinity norm of a convolution, we may use the estimate which is a product for supremum norm of function f and L1 norm of function nu, which is reciprocal on this cube to the function phi capital. So we with the supremum norm can be here contribute to the constant c, which actually produce this inequality. So if we have the symbol of pseudo differential operator with compact support within this cube Q, when its norm can be estimated as the supremum norm of a symbol of a corresponding pseudo differential. The previous estimate, where we have an estimate for a norm of pseudo differential operator with compact support within a cube, is nice, but it's rather restrictive. We want to have symbols which may not have a compact support, which may be defined on entire Euclidean space. And that is possible, it's possible to extend the previous lemma to that general situation using the covariance property 4, which we said before. So if our symbol is shifted in the phase space, when corresponding operator is just intertwined with initial operator by some unitary operator from the Schrödinger representation. So we may replace a cube Q with ages minus 1, 1 to arbitrary cube of size 2, length of the side 2, and endpoints in the odd integers, so in the lattice of all integers in the space, and we will cover the entire space by such cubes and can make estimates for each part of the symbol belonging to one particular cube. And then we will need to sum up all such estimates over all such cubes in n dimensions. That will be an infinite series, and to have a convergence we need a certain rate of decay, so cubes which will be further away from the origin shall contribute with decreasing amount, and that amount shall decrease sufficiently fast to make a convergent series. And so next lemma just describe how we can get the corresponding estimates for supremum norm of cube. For this reason, it's just enough to have certain estimates for the derivative, corresponding derivative in all variables for function f. And in order to get that conclusion, it's just necessary to use previous property 4 with respect to shifts and integrate by part that expression. So if we will integrate it by part, then expansion of that sum into polynomial will give us corresponding derivatives of the order up to 2k, which will. So, having all bits of the proof already done, we can gather everything together into that important Calderon-Weierkurt estimate theorem, which said that a pseudo-differential operator with a symbol A, where a Fourier transform of A may be dual to the Schwarz space, so it can be a distribution. If A is bounded together with all its derivatives, then that produces a bounded pseudo-differential operator on L2 space in Rn. And also important, interesting property, what if that function vanishes at infinity, so limits at infinity in any direction is equal to zero, then this operator will be a compact. So proof is just collect previous lemmas. We having such a symbol A, we decompose it into sum of symbols located in all squares with integer shifts, integer vertices, cubes with integer vertices. For each such cube, we have an estimated norm given by supremum norm of the symbol. When summing up all that functions, we get the infinite series over this cube, which is convergent by the virtue of previous lemma and corresponding demand on the derivatives. Also, the second part can be proven easily. We may just observe what if we have a smooth function A hat, then we may approximate it by functions of compact support, and such what they converge to A uniformly on compact sets. And because A vanishing in infinity, uniform convergence on the compact set imply uniform convergence all everywhere. But smooth functions are kernels, provide kernels for compact operators. So we approximate in the norm, and estimation of by the norm is given by previous part of the Calderon-Weierkurt theorem itself. So we get approximation of operator in norm by a sequence of compact operators, so resulting operator will be compact, and even Hilbert-Schmidt operator, so it's easy to demonstrate in this case. And as such, we get the proof of that theorem in theory of pseudo-differential operators, and that will be our final theoretical application of the Heisenberg group to the operator theory. And that will be a good place to stop current.